How's everybody doing today? We are here with an author, and he's going to introduce himself, introduce his novel, you know, tell us a little bit about his background and stuff. How are you doing today?
Oh, I'm doing so well. Thank you for having me on this show. I'm really excited to be here. My name's Philip Allen Darmstetter, and I'm the author of Jones C. Harver and The Watcher's Way. I heard this show has some great questions, so I'm looking forward to it.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir. So my first question for you is your novel, Jones T. Harver and The Watcher's Way. It throws the readers into a world of thrilling adventure and hidden societies. What inspired you to create this particular world and mythology?
Oh, well, you know, I used to sell free Lifeline phones right after I got out of college. And through this experience, I met many people of all different statures, you know. I had all walks of life, and these often led to intense conversations or situations. I also used to go to clubs a lot for music when I was working in the industry that required me to do so. So what inspired me to create this particular world in mythology was the way that people get stuck in their own realities. You see, when that happens, I would always see people talking to themselves on the street, or looking up at something and rambling on about things that didn't seem to make much sense to others. I often wondered, you know, how they got there and why they were living their lives the way they did. You know, often people would bring up items or situations they saw or they thought, you know, they saw along the way, and that would lead to mythologies and questions about that, and that would also lead to this world building that happened around it. So I got all my inspiration from these real life situations.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir. That's interesting. So my next question is, the character, Jones T. Harver,
yeah,
is a captivating and complex character.
Oh, what yes, expects, he is.
Yeah, what aspects of his personality were most enjoyable to develop for you as the author?
Well, Jones T. Harver is actually based after me. So I guess I'm a complex person, so that's why he's complex, you know, just kidding. But what I went through per my experiences, you know, the parts that were most enjoyable and were fun for me was when I went over my memories and personal past experiences from all the club hopping I did. You know, I was able to recall fun or funny situations that looking back on would seem ridiculous to most people. And in some ways, these situations kind of are. Developing his personality where he is adventurous, but always getting caught up in crazy situations, rides on the coattails of, like I said, much of my own life and what I personally had gone through. So some of these situations really did happen. And if you've dipped into the novel before, if you've lately heard about it, I really want you to read it. Because these situations that I'm talking about really did, you know, go on within my life. I don't want to say too much because I don't want to spoil it for the audience here, you know, who hasn't read it yet.
Yes, sir.
So.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir. No, they quite understand, you know. The story explores themes of destiny, hidden knowledge, and the fight against powerful forces. What message or ideas do you hope readers will take away from the novel?
Well, you know, I hope that the message here is never given in to yourself. And that's really what it's about, you know. Even if the world seems to be against you, you know, doesn't understand how you feel or wherever you are at any given moment in time, psychosis, it's no joke, right? I want people to recognize that they are worth more than every penny in their own lives. And what I mean by that is that money can't buy your life back. And to be able to relate to that, you're not alone in this. You know, I went through this. You know, there's no shame in being who you are, regardless of your own illnesses at any point in time, regardless of what's happening to you. You know, your soul is speaking right. And I want people to understand that these life experiences are important and that you won't be stuck like that in your mind forever. You know, don't dwell on that. Psychosis isn't an end-all be-all that people try and make it seem sometimes.
Yeah.
So
yes, sir.
That's what I mean when I'm talking about those destinies and hidden knowledge and the fight against the powerful. That's the representation.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir. That's powerful. Jones T. Harver and The Watcher's Way feels like the first chapter in a larger saga. Do you have plans for a sequel or a series featuring this character's and this world?
Absolutely. And I'm so excited And I wish I could talk about this more. We have a trilogy plan, and we're hoping to continue to gain support. So please, if you're listening to this, whenever you listen to this, spread the word. Jones C. Harver and the Coder's Call, I'll give you the title, is coming out soon. It is currently in the works of writing. I am the author, so, you know, I can't tell you that. And I understand that people often ask me if Jones ever healed. And my answer is, well, you see me doing well, right? So the second novel will be even better. I promise.
Yes, sir. Man, that's, ooh-wee, I can't wait for this. World building is a crucial element in fantasy novels. How did you go about crafting the detailed and believable setting for your story?
Well, you know, world building is an interesting thing. You know, when you're crafting the detailed and believable setting, it's how you write it in that moment, right? I actually wrote my story on my iPhone in my notes. So this was during the time when I was working and doing DoorDash around California. So each time I'd sit down and think of a situation or place I was in, I'd write for a good hour or so and then just leave it. You know, I loved writing on my iPhone in my notes because I never looked at the pages. It didn't matter how much I was writing at that point in time. I just let it flow. You know, I always looked directly at the scenery from where I was. So whenever I was in the car, I'd look up and I'd catch all the details and then I'd write about it right then and there. You know, I thought to myself, if the world itself were to be my own actual movie, what would that look like, you know, during my experiences? Because sometimes people say, you know how people say, my life is like a movie, right?
Yeah.
So my own actual thing seen by my own restrictions of life itself, what would that be? You know, the rest just started to come to me after that.
Man, so that takes me to my next question. What research did you undertake to ensure the historical and cultural references in your novel were accurate?
Well, back when I wrote the novel halfway through, I gotta tell you, man, I had my mother read through the rough draft. So I'd say my poor mother had to do a lot of the highlighting. She was really helpful in finding the inconsistencies and fact-checking the places that I was talking about in San Francisco that I visited during my experiences. As I gave her the details of the novel of where it was supposed to be, right? She was sitting on the computer reading with me. So she questioned me a lot on places that didn't match up when I talked about them, and we looked them up on Google when I was describing them to make sure that the pictures were accurate. Sometimes I actually revisited those places. So we would go to Google, pinpoint it on the map, and get the real places when I had gone through my struggles. So the historical and cultural references all came from not only interactions I had, but also the places that I looked up on Google that had statues. Like if you go around San Francisco, for example, you can actually read about all the history of San Francisco. People sometimes they just don't stop and look, but it's written in all the walls.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
Very interesting stuff.
Are there any particular authors or works that influenced your writing style or approach to storytelling in Jones T. Harver and the Watchers way?
Well, that's a great question. You know, I would say due to my own unique writing style, there's no actual influences here in any way since it was based on my personal experiences. So I didn't really have anything to look towards. Some people compared it to Kite Runner. And growing up, I read a lot of Redwall series, Harry Potter, Stephen King, and I dipped a lot into The Hitchhiker's Guide to the Galaxy and the nature of those writing styles. These certainly were subconsciously influenced my writing and were enjoyable to read with time. So the biggest work that influenced my writing style, I would have to say, would have been a group I joined a long time ago on Facebook. They were a group of people I used to just write short stories with. And believe it or not, I actually hated writing back in the day. And until I started really, really taking it seriously, I grew up to love writing later on in life.
Nice, nice. So, what is your writing process like? How long did it take you to complete Jones T. Harver and the Watcher's Way?
Well, as I was saying before, I actually used to hate writing. I grew to love it through writing short stories over time and completed a first set of short stories with that fellow group online back when I was about, I think, 16 years old.
Mm-hmm.
And it ended up being 180 pages, though it was kind of incoherent, and it still felt like an accomplishment. I would say my uncle, who wrote a novel as well under David Darmstadter. The novel's called My Monster. If you want to read that, it's a little bit older. He used to tell me, he used to take notes everywhere he would go for inspiration. So I suppose I took that one step further and wrote it right there and then in my iPhone, you know, on my notes, in my car, as I was saying before. And again, I had my mother proofread it for inconsistencies. Then my father read it for enjoyability. So then I had further help from a college student who I paid to help me edit it. And then I had paid another person to edit the whole novel on three screens using Grammarly, I think they told me. So the whole writing process and getting everything prepared took about 4 years as I started writing it in college in my room. You know, and this might sound far-fetched, but I wrote the first paragraph in the restroom when I was getting ready for my day. And this was back in, I think, 2017. Mm-hmm. It took me until 2021 to completely finish it. So I was actually pretty disappointed because I remember on Christmas, as a little nugget, I accidentally deleted most of a chapter that I had written prior, and I had to rewrite 10 pages. I couldn't recover it. I called Apple and everything. So I was showing my family member who was over for a holiday, and I accidentally selected the delete button as I was highlighting certain parts. So thankfully, I recovered some of it back.
Nice, nice. What are you currently working on? Can you share any details about your upcoming projects? You know, a lot of times, you know, I'd be let down because a lot of people be under non-disclosure. They have their team, you know, still in the process and stuff. But yeah, we wanted to know. We wanted to know, what are you currently working on right now? Can you share any details with us?
Hey, you know, you know your stuff, don't you? You must have interviewed a lot of people. Yeah. I'd love to, but I'm sorry. You know, I can't give much about Jones T. Harvard and the Coder's Call. I want it to be a surprise. It's not really that I can't, but I'm currently working on that and the trilogy set. And if I start talking about it now, you know, I want you sitting on your chair waiting, you know. Novel 2 and 3, they're still based on personal experiences, and you can definitely visit jonesandthewatchers.com for more details and services that we offer. I do want to note that we also guide people who are struggling with family members who have psychosis, and feel free to leave a message and email us if yourself or a family member needs us. We might even send you a free Kindle version. You know, we do virtual and in-person work, and we also take donations, so if you're curious about our projects, go there. Go to our website.
Yes. As a writer, what advice do you have for aspiring novelists who are crafting their own worlds and stories?
Oh, that's a good question. And honestly, I've already been over this on YouTube. So watch my YouTube. The social is right up there on the website as well. I have four, at least I think they're kind of funny, videos to keep it interesting. They're a little cheesy, but it gets to the point, and I've used all of these in my writing. So the main advice I want to say here, though, is that if you're crafting your own world and stories, having it loosely or heavily based on personal experiences, these will always propel your story along and give it substance, right? If you often find yourself writing in your head, narrating in your head, or storytelling around a campfire, you probably have a gift. And I recommend exploring that and writing it down. Eventually, this can become a great story to tell. And if you need help getting started, I think honestly, we have documentation of exactly what I did to go from point A to point B. So if I inspire you, you can give us an inquiry and I'll send it over.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir. And you spoke about psychosis earlier. Your work dwells into experience of psychosis.
Yes, sir.
What initially drew you to explore this topic in your writing?
Well, again, my personal experiences and that I went through actual psychosis. You know, I understand that psychosis is still very misunderstood and that most people don't remember what they go through when going through this section of their lives, right? I realized that if I wrote about what I went through, people could get a better understanding. I thought this would make it a very important novel, as long as people understood the purpose, you know, for people who really want to understand the way our mind thinks when going through this illness. And I wanted to make the world of the misunderstood, so to speak, understandable again. I do want to make a note that no actual death or destruction of any places have happened. If you go to San Francisco, you could see that. But rather, that was to capture a feeling of how some people viewed them. And I changed all the names and added a little extra after chapter 26 to keep it really interesting.
There can be a lot of misconceptions surrounding psychosis. How do you approach portraying the experience and that is accurate?
Well, I think to be accurate and about the situation is that psychosis isn't about telling someone you need to get help. You know what I mean? It's about being understood and not being called crazy because your perception is warped temporarily by your own imagination. Right? It's about understanding that people are using their imagination to protect themselves from their traumas. People always seem to think that these imaginative portrayals are because they got stuck in a TV show or a book, or in my case, creating it around them, or that they're just doing it just because. And it's really because it's deep-rooted in trauma and knowing when someone's going through that, especially non-drug-induced psychosis and the feelings behind it. It's how to approach a person, right? You need a lot of empathy, relatability, rather than trying to tell them no, right? Try to understand their perspectives, jump in with them, be empathetic to it, then reason with them, right? So there are other perspectives and that you're supportive of them as a person. So the person in question doesn't have to feel like they need their own world, right? To get through the everyday. I want you to recognize that a lot of their actions stem from their hobbies and interests, taking things at face value. And what I mean by face value is like if they see shark place, they might think sharks are inside, right? And that their filters and senses aren't quite there yet. And it's like a brain reset, as if you were a baby becoming an adult all over again, but in a very short amount of time. You just got to recognize that.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir. The portrayal of mental health conditions in fiction can be powerful. What role do you see your writing playing in terms of raising awareness and understanding of psychosis?
Oh, that's a great question. Thank you for asking me that. And that kind of relates to question 14. The previous question. I want to raise awareness of psychosis, as I've said in the previous question, but also want to note that most people with psychosis are extremely kind. Some will call you master, some will be okay. Those horrid stories we hear about, you know, stabbings or deaths are usually because the person didn't get someone there to support them through their imagination and show them it's just that, and their traumas. That the majority of people in psychosis are not dangerous, and those who might become dangerous need guidance to separate fiction from reality in a controlled setting, right? People in psychosis aren't inherently bad to begin with. It depends on their stories, their interests, their hobbies. What world are they trying to protect themselves with, right? How can you be a part of that world and bring them back to our grounded reality as a whole so that we don't have these situations happening too often or over and over again, right? Why did they start this journey of needing a brain reset? These are the questions we need to be answering, not treating them as if they'll never recover, putting them on medication and keeping them in their own protective world for the rest of their lives.
Yes, sir.
That's what I think.
Yes, sir. Beyond the challenges, psychosis can also include unique experiences. How do you navigate representing the spectrum of experiences someone with psychosis might have?
Well, that is a that's an in-depth question, sir. the spectrum of experiences someone with psychosis might have is an interesting question. At any given moment, they'll connect dots dependent on their habits and interests and hobbies, as I was saying, right? And what world they felt could be protective of themselves. For example, if someone really loved cotton candy, made cotton candy all their lives, and owned a cotton candy store with pink all around it, they might delve into a world that, to them, cotton candy is their safe space. Therefore, anything pink they might be drawn to, right? Navigating the spectrum of experiences also has a lot to do with emotions. Are they in shame? How far up the ladder are they climbing? I like the Omega chart, if you ever heard of that, which is a good indication of how one feels, right? You have to go through shame, for example, to feel apathy, to feel anger, to feel love again. The real key here is to really listen to their words, what they are saying, and rather than focusing on every little single detail of what they believe or don't believe is a reality, focus on where they are in a bigger picture. And that'll give you a better picture of where someone is at when you're relating to them.
Stigma surrounding psychosis can be a significant barrier to recovery. How do you integrate themes of hope, resilience, and a path to recovering within your writings?
Well, I want people to realize, as I've stated before, that psychosis is only temporary. To the point that a person of interest feels that they have to stay in their world to ignore the hard life around them. With a good support system, you can have this recovery to where they won't feel like that, right? How I incorporated this into my writing is showing the depression that I went through. I literally have a chapter called Depression Trip, which explores the feeling right before I had my full break. Having a great support system and a strong will internally can show this. Nefarious, for example, he's sort of Jones' resilience, and Mira, well, she's sort of the other half of Jones, hope and path to guidance and recovery, right? As we go further through the novel, we can see Jones further slipping into his world and then slowly recovering after a resolution is solved. So Jones, as he goes through these experiences, is him working through his own personal traumas and feeling like he doesn't have to go back there.
Yes, sir. When crafting these characters who experience psychosis, do you draw from personal experiences, research, or combinations of both?
Yeah, well, I don't know. Sometimes, right? No, I'm kidding. I draw from a combination of both. I've met many people along the way that had gone through unfortunate situations and took the time to hear them out, listen, speak with them, and understand why they got to where they were, right? Understand what they truly believed and why. I remember I was at a club in the city around Mission Street, I think it was. A guy was expressing to me that he was a king from a distant galactic planet, and I noticed, honestly, that people sometimes refer to themselves as different planets, considering we're all stardust. I guess that thought, it's not that far-fetched. So sometimes I will research the place or go towards an interesting spot. Like, for example, the Exploratorium in San Francisco is super interesting. You can go behind it and see the Coast Guard ships going to the middle of the island. These are places the public cannot go, like for the island. They can go behind the Exploratorium, but can see from the outside. So small spots like these will often spark inspiration for further writing. And talking to people like that gentleman at the time also helps drawing my inspiration. From my own personal experiences, I draw them from interactions I have and the reactions I've had afterward, right? Mm-hmm. So,
yes.
That's how I got to where I was with the novel today.
Yes. Mental health professionals play a crucial role in supporting those with psychosis. How do you ensure your services of therapists, therapists, because you don't do actually
psychiatrists. I talk to them.
You just go
ahead. Yeah, I talk to them. Give them time.
Okay, like kind of consulting, that's what your services is based off of?
Yeah, therapy and consulting. I don't really do a lot of deep psychiatry work. It is, if it's necessary, sometimes I'll talk to them in that way and do a little bit of case management. But for the most part, you know, family therapy, stuff like that. And so,
nice service.
Yes, sir. You can check it out on the website. So I want to be clear, though, with this, right? How I make sure that it's respectful and accurate is that psychiatrists, therapists, and figures of that nature are important to society in that medication is not necessarily bad. I think it's only a band-aid sometimes or most of the time, but these things are helpful. And I think if you have people who have gone through these experiences, then becoming a psychiatrist or a therapist later on in life, this could really help society relate better. So those who spend lots of money and time learning from textbooks are also really important, and there needs to be a biological and emotional mixture in today's society. And I think communities are slowly developing further towards this in the medical world. And so in my own writing, I took from my discussions and my family, who have mostly all been doctors or operational managers in the health industry and within the healthcare industry as a whole, and they were able to correct me in terms of terminology if I needed such to stay respectful to the practices. And therapists, psychiatrists, or other figures of society that are in administration, they need to be acknowledged and listened to. And their job is to give great advice and guidance in the first place and help you work through yourself internally. So I know it's harder to relate to someone if you haven't gone through it yourself, but that doesn't mean it's not valuable, you know? And it shouldn't be discredited in any type of writing.
Yes, sir. The relationship between family and friends is often vital for someone experiencing psychosis. How do you explore the complexities of these relationships in your writing?
Well, I took a lot from personal experiences, you know, as you understand, between how my family interacted and how I was behaving during the timeline. I think of what my own friends or mutual friends did during that time and what I was going through when I had these issues. I asked my mom what she did back when I was in college, how she felt. And I took from experiences and remembrance of meeting different interesting souls on the street and how they acted or reacted, including when I was in the psych ward as well. I was able to explore the complexities of each relationship by relating it to myself, to my family, and to them.
Yes. So. Beyond individual stories, psychosis can also have a broader social context. Do you explore any social factors that might contribute to or influence the experience of psychosis?
Yeah, in the writing, the novel talks about the isolation someone is going through when living in psychosis. There's a line in there that says, "Jones, sometimes we have to hide from the world. That way we fit in. That way we won't get in trouble." I believe that that was when the character, the spirit of music, is talking to him. And it's true. People who go through psychosis feel like they have to hide it because they'll be looked down upon, especially if they're still going through it. I want to tell people that that's not the case. You know, talk about it. Get the conversation going more. The more people and data society has on this, the better accommodations people with schizophrenia or psychosis will have, as well as getting rid of the illness altogether. In society, going through these things is still not socially acceptable. And I believe that this still exists as a quiet letdown rather than a public, "Oh no, you're bad, I'm gonna stay away from you," right? It's not the case and should not be the case anymore. I believe that society tends to focus too much on a person being an icon or idolization, and then we forget ourselves and our own skill sets by what you see on television. And why this matters is that television, in my personal opinion, is a worldwide psychosis. If you start to take it too seriously and forget that it's just entertainment based on actions, not reality, it's a performance, right? It's taken from theater performance back in our olden days. And society needs to remember that. TV is for to sit down and enjoy. It's not meant to be taken seriously.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir. And so last but not least, what are your hopes for readers who encounter your work that focuses on psychosis?
I hope that readers who encounter my work that focuses on psychosis will have a better understanding of what it's like. That is truly the heart and soul of this novel. And I hope that they'll be able to guide those who are going through it, better come back to reality so that they can have their family members back. I also hope that policies change to properly accommodate people in these situations so that deaths happen less often, that HIPAA laws don't prevent those in psychosis from getting lost in the streets or being tossed from psych ward to psych ward, and that those who are going through it themselves don't feel ashamed that they are who they are or went through it. You know, my own mother, for example, she thought I was dead for 4 days because she couldn't contact me, or due to HIPAA laws, she had to find me by basically going to the lady in the hospital and asking her over and over until she finally gave in privately, right? These types of things should not happen in the professional world. That's your own kin, right? You should know where they are, especially if you're not dangerous to them and you support them. I think there's a lot of good that happens too, and that humanity and society is really pushing for it as our communication grows in life. And I do want to make note of that, that I hope those who read my novel really spread the word and share it to help with the police force and medical agencies, laws, policies, and our overall understanding medically of psychosis and schizophrenia. And I know it is a bit spruced up, right? But this novel holds much value into these types of things on a broader scope. And that's so you can be mentally nourished. That's what I think.
Yes. And so we're going to end this with where can the listeners contact you and order, you know, your novel and reach out to you?
Yeah, you can reach out to me if you go to jonesandthewatchers.com. If you search up Jones T. Harver and The Watchers Way, it's on Amazon. I've got courses up on Udemy. If you just search up my name, I will come up everywhere. I promise you, it's worth checking out. So please go ahead and do that. And thank you for having me on the show, man. I really, really appreciate you.
Yes, sir. You have a nice day.
Hey, you as well.
Thank you.